and welcome. My name is Carolyn Stanford Taylor, and I am the Deputy Superintendent for the Madison Metropolitan School District. I'm also the former Wisconsin State Superintendent of Public Instruction. We're so happy to be at Frank Ellis this morning in their lovely Library Media Center with some of our scholars who are joining us by live stream and some of you who are here in person. I am pleased and excited to welcome you to our 19th annual Read Your Heart Out kickoff event. This is truly one of my favorite events of the year. Read Your Heart Out celebrates the importance of reading, community, and family engagement. Today, we'll welcome Mrs. Michelle Bell-Navis, who is the mother of Read Your Heart Out. She is joining us by Zoom, followed by our MMSD superintendent, Dr. Carlton D. Jenkins, who will share one of his favorite books with you. Today's event also honors National African American Parent Involvement Day, which promotes African American parent and family involvement and engagement in their children's education. As educators and the community, we know how important it is for families to be partners in their child's education. We also know, as Dr. Jenkins will say, it is critical for schools to be in the community and the community in our schools. That's why later today, you'll hear from your principal at ALIS, Ms. Candace Terrell, and J.T. Wu, the founder and executive director of Preface, the nonprofit organization who so generously donated new books to ALIS's students today. Throughout this month, our brilliant MMSD scholars will have the opportunity to hear even more books read from African-American staff, family members, and community members. These stories demonstrate the strength, beauty, and contributions of African-Americans to our society. These stories uplift our district's values of excellence, belonging, creativity, and more. Now, let's celebrate reading and literacy in our schools and community. Please join me in welcoming Mrs. Michelle Bell-Navis, mother of Read Your Heart Out.
Lift every voice and sing till earth and heaven ring. Ring with the harmonies of liberty. Let our rejoicing rise high as the listening skies. Let it resound loud as the rolling sea. Sing a song full of the faith that the dark past has taught us. Sing a song full of the hope that the present has brought us. Facing the rising sun of our new day begun, let us march on till victory is won. Thank you to my queen, Carolyn Stanford Taylor, for your guidance, inspiration, and leadership that has set such a strong foundation for me as a classroom teacher, culturally responsive teacher leader, district and statewide professional development trainer, and mother and founder of Read Your Heart Out. I bring you warm greetings and heartfelt love from Charlotte, North Carolina, where I now reside. I am Michelle Bell-Navis, a retired Madison Metropolitan School District 40-year educator. However, this work of building strong school, family, and community relationships never retires. As Read Your Heart Out has spread its wings from Madison, Wisconsin, to the land of the Cherokee and Shawnee in Charlotte, North Carolina, thank you all for keeping Read Your Heart Out alive and well in 30 plus schools and 8 school districts throughout the state of Wisconsin and newly piloted in Charlotte, North Carolina as Read Your Heart Out with Koma Adikon. The use of culturally responsive books authored and illustrated by African-Americans reflect unity, purpose, collective work and responsibility, cooperative economics, faith, creativity, and self-determination. Reading these books in honor of National African American Parent Involvement Day, set forth by our ancestors, are rooted from a bedrock of love. Our history can no longer be a mystery. A shout out to all elementary schools in the Madison Metropolitan School District who continue to make history with record number participation. Born at Midvale Elementary School in 2004, I thank you to Alice Principal Terrell and Superintendent Jenkins for leading by example, lifting up and holding up our most striving to succeed students and their families. I'm so excited that tomorrow I get to read with the genius scholars and students at Marquette via Zoom. And I dedicate this Read Your Heart Out 2023 in its 19th year to my dear friend and colleague, 38-year Madison Metropolitan School District educator, Stephanie Ann Wilson Bernard. Stephanie was integral in the creation of Read Your Heart Out, and the Madison Metropolitan School District salutes her. You will forever be remembered on Read Your Heart Out Day for your tireless dedication and commitment to sharing the power and love of reading with all of your students. You will always be in our hearts. I would love for you to refer to the website, Madison Metropolitan School District, readyourheartout.org, to watch a video dedicated to her with a book reading of Undefeated, gifted to me from Mendota Elementary School, written by Kwame Alexander. I look forward to celebrating Read Your Heart Out with you. I look forward to the 20th anniversary coming up next year. Welcome to Read Your Heart Out. The best is yet to come. It has been paved with bold steps. So always remember to be the first to love and continue to persevere. Thank you and welcome to Read Your Heart Out.
Wow, Ms. Bell Navis, I want to just say thank you so much. You've inspired us here in MMSD. You've inspired our community. You continue to inspire around the world, really. For you to have been a part of starting, being the founder, thinking about culturally relevant material for our students is just outstanding. As superintendent of Madison Metropolitan School District, I couldn't be prouder of this particular moment, knowing that we're in the 19th year of celebration with our students of Read Your Heart Out. This is quite significant, students, I tell you. And I want to thank Ms. Stafford Taylor for the introduction of this moment. And I definitely want to lift up your friend too, Stephanie, as she has given great work and was there in the beginning of this as well. Today, we're going to have an opportunity to read our favorite book. But let me say this before we do. Reading itself is not just important in MMSD, but it's very important in MMSD. As a district, we have made a historic investment in early literacy in MMSD. We're talking about curriculum materials for you all. And we wanted to make sure that those materials were definitely where you could see yourself in the materials that we have. We've invested in the science of reading because we know that's important to help all of us. And in the beginning, our foundations are so important. So wherever you are, when you come to MMSD, we want to make sure that you leave out of here, not just a reader, but a great reader, so that you can go on and do all those fabulous things as we know that you can. I'm looking at you sitting here right now today, and I say, wow, our future is bright with the students of MMSD. So I'm going to start, and I said early on, I'll tell my secret to the world. I love Alice. I love Mendota. And so the student asked me, do you tell everyone that everywhere you go? Actually, I love all the students, but I do favor Alice and Mendota just a little bit. Okay. So that was a great question. The reason I bring that up, and whenever you're around individuals, make sure you do that. Raise great questions. this is going to fall into, when I get to read this book, you're going to find out a little bit about one of my favorite individuals. I am Dr. Carlton D. Jenkins, the very proud superintendent here in Madison, Wisconsin, Madison Metropolitan School District. And I'm going to get ready to start reading my favorite book. And this is about Mr. Lonnie Johnson. Mr. Johnson himself, wait until we get in this book. You're going to find out some incredible things about him, okay? So maybe you've already read his book already, but Chris Barton, you know, we're talking about the author. You always want to know that. And who did the illustration as well? And that's Mr. Dante as well. You see the book here? Swoosh. How many of you have read this book? Okay. All right. Well, this is going to be a great book that I'm going to encourage you to read. Because as I've read his book here even recently, I was inspired again. Every time I go back through it, I'm inspired by this particular book. So we're going to start off here. And I want to talk about Mr. Johnson just a little bit before I get into the book itself. He's from Alabama, and I'm from Alabama. So that made it special to me. He actually attended a college at Tuskegee University. That's a historical Black college and university. And throughout his book, we'll get to a point where he actually talks about the significance of his journey. And I want you to make sure you pay close attention. But often he was found just like this, looking out the window. Let's read a little bit about it. Every day brought a challenge for young Lonnie Johnson. The challenge of finding space for his stuff, just all of his stuff. You know, Mr. Johnson had things, his parents had six kids and were squeezed into their parents' small house in Mobile, Alabama. Lonnie would have loved a workshop of his own, but there just wasn't room. There was nowhere to keep his rocket kits. How many of you like rockets? Okay, outstanding. And a lot of times you're thinking about all of these wild things. Listen to Mr. Johnson himself. He said he had things everywhere, you know, like bamboo shooters, rubber band guns, you know, all kinds of things out there, bolts and screws and other spare parts. His dad let him bring in from the shed and various other things. He hauled back from the junkyard. Going to the junkyard, Mr. Johnson here. Look at him right here, you all. You see him? He had all of this stuff from the junkyard, from the shed and everything like this. He's just trying to figure something out. Lonnie loved building and creating ideas for inventions, just kept him flowing. His mind just flowed. How many of you are thinking about creative things that you really would like to do you haven't done yet? How many of you like me? Wow, I can see the genius in this room. I really can. A lot of you probably more like Mr. Johnson. Hey, and you can do that, okay? He learned how to make rockets from scratch. Kids at school gathered to watch Lonnie launch them. And he learned how to make rocket fuel. That's interesting. And then when it caught fire in the kitchen, Lonnie's mom didn't make him stop. How amazing. She just sent him to work outside. That's amazing. Always think about it. Your parents support you. No, she didn't knock him down. She didn't knock his ideas. She knew that he was something special. Lonnie wanted to spend his life designing things, building things, and getting them to work. He wanted to be an engineer. However, Lonnie took an exam that said he would not make a very good one. Listen at that. Wow. His dream had been challenged. Lonnie was discouraged, but he knew that whoever had graded his test hadn't met Lennox. And we'll find out who Lennox is in just a minute. How many of you ever been told that you couldn't do something already? You ever been told that? But Lonnie kept going, right? So inspired by a TV show, Lonnie had built his own robot. He made it out of scrap metal and named it Lennox. Compressed air cylinders and valves allowed Lennox's body to turn, its arms to move. The switches came from an old broken jukebox. Lonnie used a tape recorder to program Lennox. And as a bonus, the reels looked like eyes. Look at that. Lonnie wanted to enter his creation at a science fair, but he couldn't get transmitters to work. Without it, Lonnie could send commands. With it, Lonnie could send those commands. Look at the robot. See the robot, Lennox there? Yeah, look at his mouth. Looked like a real person, right? That's it. They say science fairs came and went.
Lonnie missed one and then another until he got an idea. Now Lonnie may or may not have asked before. He borrowed his little sister's walkie-talkie. He borrowed his little sister's walkie-talkie without asking it. Now, you know how that could go, right? Any of you have any siblings? You have younger siblings?
Four.
Yeah, that's awesome. But the transmitter, it fixed his issue. His school's team took freshly finished Linux to a 1968 science fair at the University of Alabama, where only 5 years earlier, African-American students had even been allowed. Wow. He went and entered in a contest where 5 years later, African-American students couldn't go to the university. What do you think that meant?
Segregation.
There were what?
Segregation.
Segregation. Wow. Did you hear that? Many of you know about segregation?
Yeah.
Okay, great. I'm glad to know that we're learning about that here in our school.
Because back then, Black people had the same thing. They had worse things. They even had to split the water
fountain. They had to split the water fountains, black water fountains and white water fountains. Right. That's a very important point that he's making, and I'm so glad that our scholars are on top of that. So thank you to our great teachers here for making sure that our students are well equipped. It says, having to compete in a place that still wasn't very welcoming. Now, that was a challenge with a capital C. Against other schools from all over the state, Lunny's team won first place. Do you understand that? They were first place competing against all these other schools and just coming out of this challenge, big challenge, because some schools, even though this was 1968, they had not integrated in Alabama to like 1973.
So I'm pretty sure some of them know why, and they had better things. They just didn't
listen. Wow, that was powerful. Did you all hear that? What he said? Some of the schools were white schools and they had better resources. Thank you for sharing that. That's too okay.
That is back in 2003.
Say that again?
The last campaign after that still allowed slavery, it ended back in 2003.
Wow. Slavery ended in some other countries, you said, in 2003?
Yeah.
Okay, wow. I'm glad to see that you're talking around the world, too. I can tell a lot of you have brains just like Lenny. You're very curious, but you also very, very aware about a lot of things that you could change. It says, soon Lonnie left home, go to college at Tuskegee Institute, where he stood out as a self-confident, insightful, creative thinker. He stood out as a student who asked the right questions, precisely defined problems, and formulated solutions. And he stood out as the guy who built his own booming system out of a cast electronic. Checked out this. It even had lights that flashed in sync with the beat. Look at this. You know, not only was he just very creative, he liked to have fun, too. That's what I take out of this. When he went to college and make sure it's a balance in life, work hard every day, but make sure we have fun. I like the way
Like technology, there's like music sectors and the color is the lines get higher and more color and more like brighter every time you got longer it is.
Wow, I'm gonna tell you something. You really are beginning to sound like an engineer to me already, but I don't want to limit you with that because there's things out there like artificial intelligence. Remember that artificial intelligence that's beginning to come about, that's already here. I can see your mind working on something like that and solving a lot of our problems.
Yes, like this is the first school that I saw.
This is the first school that you've seen that had a black principal?
Yes.
Wow. Is she amazing or what? Yes. Wow, she is amazing. Yes. Let's go on. It said, Lonnie sometimes studied night in the middle of his own parties, right? He's partying with everyone, but he's studying at the same time. The extra studying paid off. He became an engineer after graduation, and that took him beyond Alabama. Way beyond Alabama. Who knows where Alabama is on the map? You know what? Is it in the north or is it in the south?
South.
Very good. Very good.
And like slavery.
Yeah. Well, we can talk about slavery at another time, but you're exactly right. A lot of individuals from Alabama, my own family history, I'm fifth generation, a child of a slave, okay? So, but we can talk about that later. All right, it says, when NASA was sending an orbiter and probe called Galileo to Jupiter, the space agency needed to ensure a constant supply of power to the orbiter's computer memory. The engineer who had to figure this out, guess who it was?
Yes,
it was Mr. Johnson, Lenny Johnson, okay? His challenge was to come up with a lightweight backup system able to keep essential functions going in case the main power was lost. It wasn't easy, it wasn't obvious, but Lenny found a solution. Some at NASA's jet propulsion laboratory doubted his idea would work. Lenny convinced them that it would. He was right. As it's photographed Jupiter and its moon, Galileo, all was supported by a power package that Lenny designed. He was an awesome guy. Look at the design when he was working with everybody here at Galileo.
That's nice.
You see it?
Yeah. Yeah.
And that's the work that you put in. When you study hard, right? You study hard, believe it or not.
I'm pretty sure NASA still has the pictures of Mars.
Oh, yeah, most definitely. We want to continue to study out of space, and they're doing it now. In fact, one of my friends from college, he's one of the big people at NASA right now. He graduated from Mississippi Valley State. Ideas for problems to solve just kept coming and just flowing this air. He said they flowed whether Lenny was working with hundreds of people at NASA or up late tinkering with his own inventions. And finally, his own workshop. He finally got his own workshop. Lenny knew the world's millions of refrigerators and air conditioners needed a new cooling system. One that didn't use R12, a chemical that was bad for the environment. Listen at that. He was thinking about everyone else, thinking about the environment. We want to be environmentally friendly when we're doing things. I appreciate the fact that he was thinking that. He had an idea for using water and air pressure instead. To test his idea, he made a pump and nozzle, connected them to the bathroom faucet, turned on the pump, and then guess what happened?
The water sprayed out.
Yeah, exactly.
So he made the water.
Yes, that's it. This is what happened. Whoosh. That's what happened. It says the system, the stream that blasted across the room was so powerful, it created a curtain swirling breeze. It also gave Lenny an idea but yet another invention.
Power
this
washer.
Guy's always thinking.
Power
all right?
Washer.
That's a great idea. That's a great idea. Power. I won't go there yet. It says this, he thought, would make a great water gun. How many people play with water guns? Okay. Listen at this, what he did next. After he had this big idea, it says first he had to find or make the parts, including a pump small enough for a child to handle. Then he had to glue the parts together into a prototype, an early version with room for improvement. Now, look at this. Bam! Right? We've all been out with the super soakers, right?
Yeah.
It says, finally, Lenny tested his strange-looking squirt gun at a picnic. Does it really work? A man asked. Sure, Lenny said. Want to see? Lenny worked the pump. Wow. Which squeezed into an air chamber. When he pulled the trigger, the air escaped, forcing water out of the gun. Look at that, right? Have you been out there with a
That looks like a prototype gun.
Well, that was beginning to be his prototype at first, the way it looked in the beginning. And I actually remember when he first did this too, because like I told you, I'm from Alabama, we were all celebrating what he had done. But even when you come up with something, you still have to convince other people. It says, for a water battle to be a fair fight, there couldn't be just one of Lenny's water guns. He needed help making more. So he went to a toy company after toy company. The word no flowed again and again, but finally one company said yes. It planned to make his water gun. Lenny also had other projects, a water-propelled toy airplane, two kinds of engines, and his cooling system. he found investors to provide the money for turning this idea, his idea, to proceeds. Wow. Now he's in the business of making a little bit of money behind his ideas. He made a leap of faith, quit his day job, and devoted himself to full-time just inventing things. Sometimes when you believe something with all of your might, see that right there?
Yeah.
It says, yeah, definitely. It said, but soon each plan fell apart, even the one for the water gun. These things sometimes happen. But when they happen, one after another, to the same person, well, that's sometimes pretty bad luck. It really is. But you're just trying. You keep trying. Sure. Leonard didn't have a job. He didn't have the money he'd been counting on. He and his family had to move out of their home and into a little apartment. That sounds like my family. We had 8 people living in a small apartment called the Projects. Yeah. And then after that, he was angry and scared, but he didn't give up. But Lenny had dealt with challenges all his life. He knew a lot about solving problems, and he still believed in his inventions, especially the water gun. Lenny went looking for another toy company. Well, sometimes when you're looking, luck follows your way. In 1989, he found a toy maker who was interested in seeing the water gun if Lenny ever happened to be in Philadelphia, if he ever happened to be. But ambitious as he was, but Lenny said, hey, the guy had said to him, but don't make a special trip. The guy said, Lenny made a special trip. You know how somebody, you have a big idea, and somebody say, take your time, and then you're anxious, right? He said, no, I'm going right now. So that's what Lenny did. He jumped on a plane and went out there to share it. In his wife's suitcase, he carried a new prototype. He unpacked it, filled the tank with water, pumped the gun until the air pressure was good and hot. And guess what happened?
It's squirting.
You're exactly right. Whoosh! It came out, and look at all those potential investors, what they were doing, right? Soaking back. Well, basically, at that particular point, we know the rest of the story. We all start going out, buying water guns. Kids were all out in the park, and everyone agreed that this was a great idea. And that was the beginning of the super soaker, okay, that we know. How many of you have a super soaker?
I have a water gun.
Yeah. You have just a regular water gun, not a power pump?
I have multiple
water guns. Have you ever gone against somebody who didn't have a big power super soaker? Who wins the battle? Exactly. So let me close with this here. It said, so what did Lenny do? He got a bigger workshop after coming up with this particular invention here, right? Well, you would find him today because facing challenges, solving problems, and building things are what Lenny Johnson loves to do. And his ideas just keep on going. And so that's the Lenny Johnson story. But I found it interesting here. And I want to just take a second to read you this, because the author sometimes gets to know individuals, and then they'll write a little note about it. This is what the author said about the super soaker. A super soaker uses pump to compress the air found in its water reservoir, which puts pressure on the water when the trigger is pulled. The pressurized water can escape and whoosh. If you search the internet for how super soakers work, you'll find a lot more about what goes on inside Lenny's head, this very famous guy. But if you want to better understand how Lenny Johnson himself works, then you'll put this book down and step away from the computer screen and get permission from yourself to begin to make your ideas come alive. And so as I was talking to you, I know amongst us, we have a number of individuals who have great ideas. Show me a hand if you have great ideas, okay? And so I see a potential for a lot of Lenny Johnsons in this particular book. And I'm gonna encourage you to go ahead and do your best. Is there something else that you would like to ask about this book that I didn't bring out for you? Anybody have any questions? Okay, and this question doesn't have a question. So I know, okay, we have a big question in the back.
You older than him?
Am I older than him? Well, not quite. That's a great question, okay? I can tell you right now that you're going to be a big time doctor someday, working for the World Health Organization as you're trying to figure these things out. Okay. Great question. I am 57. Mr. Johnson is just a little bit older than that. Yeah. When he went to school and he was in that whole first experiment, I wasn't quite there yet. I was still in pre-K, as they say. So we're close in age, about 20 some years. So, anyone else? Great question. Let me say to you, when's my birthday? November the 27th, 1965. Old. Close. When's your birthday?
November 17th.
November 17th. That's my brother's birthday. Well, let me just say to Ms. Terrell, I really appreciate being here at Alice. I really appreciate this group. They have a lot of great questions, and I know that you're going to be impacting the world as they go up and they do magnificent things out there. All of us, please continue to read. Continue to read and help others read as well, okay? Great space. And Mr. Wu, thank you for donating these books. Thanks, everyone, for the time today. Thanks, everybody out there who live stream as well, okay?
All right. Well, thank you again, Dr. Jenkins, for that wonderful story. Hi, Ms. T, Principal Terrell, and on behalf of Alice, we want to thank you just for being here with us today and spending that time. As we've kind of heard today that, you know, this idea of school, it extends far beyond the walls that we're in today, right? It really requires the support of parents. It requires the support of communities. It requires businesses and nonprofits. And in total, nonprofits have provided, as well as all of these organizations, have provided over 23,000 hours of volunteer service to schools. They've also given over 1 million in financial material resources to schools. So we want to lift that and we want to say thank you. We also want to thank personally our Adopt-A-School partners, United Church of Christ and United Health. Thank you for all that you do for us at Alice. I'd also like to thank Madison Schools Public Schools Foundation for their support of Alice and the entire district. And finally, but definitely not least, I wanna thank JT Wu and the Preface organization for their gifts of books to our students. We are extremely thrilled and excited for the gifts to all of our students. The gift of reading and to continue reading, it means the absolute most to allow students to transcend any barriers that they may experience in their lives. So your organization is doing amazing work, and I want to ask everyone to join me in welcoming JT Wu.
Gosh, thank you so much, y'all. Well, good morning. Hey, scholars. Hey, everybody else in the room. What's going on? Thank you all so much for being here. First of all, I want to say thank you to Michelle Belnavis, Superintendent Dr. Carlton Jenkins, Deputy Superintendent Carolyn Stanford Taylor, Camille Grace, of course, Nuri Castillo Crawford, all of our friends, Board Chair Allie Mulder, I think is here in the room somewhere. Thank you guys so much for welcoming us into your home, into your community. I'll be quick because I'm based in Georgia, which is near Alabama. Y'all know where that is, but it's also very warm down there usually, and it is very cold up here for a Georgia boy. So I will keep this quick. My name is JT Wu. I'm the founder and executive director of Preface. I'm joined by our co-president, Naval Lieutenant David Bai over here as well. And we're an award-winning and nationally recognized 501c3 nonprofit, which is just a charity for y'all. And we're focused on early childhood literacy, so making sure that you guys have everything that you need to read and to succeed. And it's an honor on behalf of both myself and the entire Preface team to be standing here today in beautiful Madison alongside folks at Alice and so many inspiring leaders and educators as we kick off Read Your Heart Out. And so, you know, our mission at Preface is to foster equality through education and early childhood literacy. And we love bringing communities together all across America to really bolster that spirit of service and learning and to create local solutions that are meeting local needs, always at no cost to our amazing elementary schools. And we do that by training high school students in communities, many of whom are multilingual, they come from diverse backgrounds, and we train them in reading best practices. And then we pair them up with local scholars like y'all to read and get to know each other and to really enhance literacy in small groups and make sure that you guys have all the tools that you need to achieve your dreams and to be successful. And what we do at Preface goes far beyond just setting up reading sessions and fueling these mentorship sessions. But we love to donate libraries of books, just like you guys see in front of you today. So just quick show of hands. How many of you guys love superheroes or princess books or adventures? Yeah, you got that out here? Perfect. We'll have all of that stuff and more, plus stories just like Lonnie Jackson's about how you can achieve your dreams by just, you know, putting your head down and getting to work and believing in the possibilities that are out there. And so it's a privilege to be here on behalf of Preface, presenting this gift to Alice Elementary in celebration of our first ever partnership here in the great state of Wisconsin, but also in celebration of all that our amazing educators and partners are doing right here in this room and across this school. Because especially during these challenging times, you know, these incredible educators with us here from MMSD and from Alice, they're shining examples of how amazing and caring folks right here in Madison are working to transform young lives and to set them on the path to lifelong learning success, thanks to their love, their heart for their students, and just a little bit of innovation. And so on behalf of all of us at Preface, again, thank you for welcoming us into your homes and into your community. We are so honored to be able to gift this legacy gift of hundreds of representative and diverse and inclusive children's books to be enjoyed by generations of kids here at Alice and in Madison for years to come. And we're excited to work with y'all to ensure that every child in Wisconsin has all the foundations and the educational opportunities, no matter where they live or what language they speak, to achieve and pursue their own American dreams. So thank y'all so much. And I'll turn it back over to our amazing hosts. Thank you, guys.
Thanks, kids.
I again would like to give my thanks to JT and to Preface for this wonderful donation. And as you look around this library and you look at all these beautiful books that have been donated here to Frank Alice, it will make a world of difference. So thank you so very much for that. And you all heard a wonderful story from Dr. Jenkins. There were lessons in there. There were so many good nuggets. I was sitting there listening and thinking about the main lesson in that. Is to never give up on your dream. If you have a dream, work for it. Don't let someone tell you that you can't do it. And the big message today is to read. There is so much in reading. And I heard the brilliance of all of you sitting out here when you were talking about engineering and all of the things that you're interested in. Keep those interests alive and well. So in the spirit of reach your heart out and to continue the legacy of Mrs. Belnavis, we encourage the parents and families to read with our students, to keep this alive, and to not only read about the contributions of African Americans this month and today, but throughout the year. And then talk with your friends and families about the books that you're reading and why they should learn about these important people too. Teachers, staff, parents, and families, continue to talk to your scholars about the contributions of African Americans. It may be civil rights leaders like Martin Luther King Jr., or perhaps scientists, George Washington Carver, or author and trailblazer, James Baldwin. Or maybe it's lawmakers like Shirley Chisholm or Bell Phillips. How many of you know that we just named our high school Bell Phillips Memorial High School? Now that's history right here with us today. We know that you all have limitless possibilities. You are brilliant. Don't let anybody tell you you're not. So today we're here to celebrate you, your successes. We're also here to support you on your journey to excellence. And most importantly, do know that we believe in you and the power you have to write your own story. So thank you all for being here. And I will have Dr. Jenkins have the last word.
Thank you, Jim. Students, you're amongst history right now. And I'm going to ask three people to come to the front. When you have Principal Terrell, Board Chair, first African-American, and our first African-American state superintendent. This is history. Next month, we're gonna have Women's History. And I released the podium to say that you're amazing. And I was just really so amazed and so wooed by you all, the questions and the way that our scholars, all of you, were asking the questions. But I want you to know that you're amongst history. You don't have to look back, way back, to find history. History is amongst us, and you can create your own history. That's what I want to do.